manufactured here.
Oh,
a lightweight drug with sensors so that when a stroke victim can't grasp or close their hand, the glove will sense the nerve's desire and close the hand around the object, like a fork or a steering wheel. And that person's life gets so much better. Eye roll is replaced with, "Oh, wow, that's such good news." Sometimes knowing the components isn't enough. Sometimes we have to understand the end result for the issue to matter. and we're distrusting one another, and we're finger pointing, and here's a whole list of everything that's going wrong. And just one on this long list of so many things going wrong in our Christian community since you went away are whether or not Christians eat meat after it's been roasted and offered to some Roman god or Greek god or Far Eastern god in a temple in this city. Is this practice sacrilege or is it good economy? People pay money and buy this meat, and then it's roasted, and then the priests in the temple have to do something to dispose of the meat. So, having already been paid for the meat, having the roasted meat, needing to dispose of the meat, they create these restaurants right there in the temple. And they sell the meat at a discounted price. And it's kind of like Chima, because you can get goat and you can get lamb, and they walk around with chicken and ox, and because it's not for Jews only, they have pork. If you don't have money to raise your own, you can go to the temple and get a great meal at a great price. Is this sacrilege or is this good economy? And Paul says, Beloved, we who have been in the faith for a while, we followers of Jesus Christ, we know there is one God. We know there's one God. And this meat that's been offered and prayed over and sacrificed to these idols, that's nothing to us. Eating this meat is not going to interfere in our relationship with God. It can't draw us closer. It can't draw us further. It's nothing to us. We can eat it freely, with no worries about our conscience or behavior. But beloved, there are new members in our faith, new members who have been worshiping in these temples and these other gods, and they are confused by this. And when they see you eating in the temple, they're not sure what to believe. It confuses them, and it weakens their resolve. And when they have weak resolve, they feel guilty about this. So seeing you eating this meat, it's an obstacle in their relationship with God. And when you argue about it, you are creating a breach in the community, and that has repercussions. What Paul is talking about is part of the human condition, part of our human brokenness. And it is that too often when we learn something, when we come to a point of view, that point of view becomes very important to us. We become very attached, and we value our own opinion greatly, and in so doing, we become a little arrogant, and we inflate the importance of our point of view. We inflate the importance of our determination to the detriment of our relationships. Being right becomes more important than being in the bounds of mutual affection with one another. And this inflation of our point of view creates problems in churches. I love right one. I love that language, that prayer of humble access. That's the prayers of my great-grandmother. We sat right there and we said it together. I love right one. I hate right one. I hate right one. It goes on and on forever, and I get lost in it, and my child is squirming around in the pew, and I can't concentrate. I hate right two. I love Anglican hymns. I love the pace, and I love the theology, and I sat with my grandmother, and we sang those. I hate Anglican hymns. I budget, and it's just perfect. I look at the budget, I think they've lost their minds. This elevating